actually, I'm not even going to use that because that won't work for me. Hi, everybody. My name is Peter Pouliot. I am a senior SDET with Microsoft. I've been effectively driving OpenStack into Microsoft for just about the last 3 years. I've been a Microsoft employee for the last year and a half. You know, we're here today to discuss Microsoft technologies and the OpenStack ecosystem. I'd like each you guys, you want to introduce yourself, Alessandro?
Peter, you want to hand us that mic?
Oh, yeah, sure.
That's a great idea.
Share.
My voice, I always get told I'm too loud, so I'll let the loudness work for itself today.
Okay, check, can you hear me? Okay, perfect. So my name is Alessandro Pilotti. I'm the CEO of Cloud-Based Solutions. We are actually actively working in the OpenStack community and contributing quite a lot of bits, starting from the Hyper-V driver up to the Cloud-Based init, which is the Windows Club init. We work on Crowbar and lots of other areas which are strictly related with the integration of Microsoft technologies and OpenStack.
My name is Joseph George. I'm the Director of Cloud and Big Data Solutions at Dell. I'm also on the Board of Directors for the OpenStack Foundation. And we've been a part of the OpenStack movement since 2010, since the very first day that it announced. We also have a few solutions in market today on OpenStack. We also run the Crowbar project that features deployment and provisioning for OpenStack, as well as some other technologies like Hadoop and Ceph. And we just recently announced some work that we've done with SUSE, with Microsoft, and with Cloudbase on enabling Hyper-V as part of our SUSE Cloud partnership with SUSE for OpenStack.
Hello. Hi, guys. My name is Georgiy Okrokvertskhov, and I'm a program manager in Mirantis. And I'm leading two projects named Morana, which is Windows for the OpenStack, and Mistral, which is recently announced as a workflow as a service. And my primary role in the Mirantis is to talk with our like enterprise customers and non-enterprise customers who usually wanted to run Windows payloads on top of the OpenStack clusters.
And I'm Das Kamhout, principal engineer in Intel IT, and I run cloud infrastructures and consume cloud infrastructures and everything in between.
So I figured we'd start off basically talking about some of the challenges that we see specifically with bringing Windows into an OpenStack environment. Now, obviously, each of us have sort of different areas that we're focusing on there. So if you'd please, you know, I guess start with what it is exactly that are the key components of Microsoft technologies that you're addressing in the work that you're doing. And then maybe give a couple statements about some of the key areas that you see as primary challenges with enabling Microsoft technologies in the work that you're doing. Okay. So I guess we can start with Das. You want to start from your side and we'll work.
Sure. Okay. So in Intel IT, we have a fairly large infrastructure. We run a design grid, which is about 60,000 servers, and this is mostly an open source environment. And then like most enterprise shops, we run a traditional IT environment, which has quite a bit of Windows infrastructure. You know, Active Directory, like most enterprises have, Kerberos authentication, and plenty of Windows guests to run various applications. And we also run actually two private clouds, but the reason we're here and the reason I'm here is we run an OpenStack private cloud that we've been running for the last couple of years. So for us, the integration points are mainly Keystone backing to Active Directory. So obviously we already have identity existing in our environment, so we want to reuse that and consume that. And that's working actually pretty well. And then obviously the guests. So we run quite a few guests, and like most shops, we have a lot of .NET in our environment, as well as other programming languages. So having Windows as a functioning guest that can be controlled is pretty key to us. We don't use Hyper-V yet in this environment. I actually just found out that there was a Hyper-V connection. So for us, it's really about to answer your point, Peter. How do we make sure that Windows and Microsoft technologies work really well on top of various OpenStack options, whether it's on various hypervisors that we would choose or bare metal, so can it be controlled, very easily. If you look at even things like Heat and a lot of the next generation things, like I just sat through a Docker discussion, most of these are really built towards Linux initially. And generally what we see in the community is not a strong leaning towards the fact that enterprises do run a lot of Microsoft. So it'd be good to see more focus there from the community, and glad to hear that you guys are taking a good part on the lower Hyper-V level. And then secondly, a realization that we do have a lot of Kerberos, Active Directory, and making sure that's just a systematic component that connects through. So
I just have a question about your usage of Active Directory with Keystone. Are you currently using it for both user and tenant ID? Are you doing direct mappings at that level?
Yeah, not to roles yet. So right now, we basically, and we will, right now it's just based off environment and tenant. So, and actually we back it with OpenDJ, which then actually connects into Active Directory.
So you know, I just want to make you also aware that CERN did the work to enable tenant ID mapping, group ID mapping, and role ID mapping directly from Keystone to Active Directory via the LDAP drive.
Excellent. And it's in trunk? Nice.
So, yeah, it's been there since, what, Folsom?
1 year, I guess.
Yeah.
So beautiful.
Native LDAP driver, so you might want to check that out. We can easily put you in contact with
them. Hey, thank you.
We've stumbled into a customer conversation between IT and Intel like and Microsoft, yes.
Sorry, guys. Got to make sure I cover all bases.
Hey, so those are a couple things I'll cover now. I'll embellish more later. But
Georgie, bud.
Yep. Yeah, let's do this. Yeah, so from Mirantis perspective, what we see that there is a huge demand from the customers to run Windows workloads on top of OpenStack. And the typical challenging area is to actually enable all Microsoft features working on top of OpenStack. The typical example actually is Microsoft clustering. So Microsoft clustering is very like huge feature which enables you to create fault tolerant configuration and Windows services, but it simply did not work on the previous releases of OpenStack just because of virtual IP assignment, for example. So by default, Nova driver does not allow you to use like any virtual IP, which is not assigned by the Nova, but usually you do not assign it from Nova. And it was fixed actually by some quantum, I'm sorry, like right now it's Neutron, but by Neutron commit in Havana. So right now, at least you can use Microsoft clustering with using secondary IP feature in the Neutron. And right now, you can run Microsoft failover cluster configurations on top of OpenStack. But of course, there are a lot of different things. So first of all, you have to prepare specific Windows image to run it efficiently on KVM. Or if you wanted to use Hyper-V, then you have to use specific images and thanks for Alessandro, so he has Windows 2012 image published on his site, so you can just download it and try to use it. And it's already pre-built for both KVM and Hyper-V, and I believe for Zen
as well.
And for Zen as well. So, and this is from like operational perspective, but also, we see that there are lots of problems with Windows configuration itself. So typically, when IT department installs OpenStack privately, there are a lot of end users who wanted to use this OpenStack. And right now, what they can do, they can just spin up a VM, and then they should go and configure those VM and install all the components manually, and usually it's painful. So in Mirantis, what we did, we created a service named Murana, so probably someone is familiar with that. And right now we are trying to simplify this painful stuff, and we provide just a simplistic UI where you can literally like drag and drop different Microsoft services and then deploy it with one click. So this is one of our approach to solve this painful problem with Microsoft Windows configuration.
Joe?
Yeah, so at Dell, we actually have a really unique perspective in terms of customers that are approaching us. So in addition to us participating with a number of the, actually everybody on this panel, on enabling Hyper-V with the Crowbar project that we own and that we're leading, but obviously it's not just Dell exclusive. We also have the privilege of servicing customers that are not ready yet to consume OpenStack in the way that it's available, right? So it is very much a development environment now. It's very much, very much developer-oriented. You have to have a certain sophistication to use it. So we have customers that are very well, acclimated to how Microsoft does its private cloud business just in general and how VMware and others run their private cloud businesses. They are watching what's happening in the OpenStack world, yet they're not able to consume it in the way that, a lot of us in this room are. So one of the benefits that we hope to provide is to help start bridging that gap. What are the tools? What are the best practices? What are the services that we can, what is the training that we can offer to those customers to start bringing them a little bit more over? Right now, a lot of us in the room, and I actually believe this as well, look at how these large-scale public clouds run their clouds, right? Continuous deployment, automation, distributed architectures. Those are still relatively new concepts to the mainstream enterprise. And so in addition to us trying to bring those concepts over to the mainstream, we're also trying to figure out what interim products, what interim services, what can we do to help enable those that are very comfortable with Microsoft products, what integration points can we offer, and how can we make them more comfortable to understand some of the new cloud tenants that come with OpenStack, right, and the new applications that need to be developed. So we look at it from both perspectives, which is actually, it's a good thing for us to be in.
So I would say this is a step from pure infrastructure layer to more platform.
Right,
layer.
Exactly.
So I would say that the challenges that we are facing can be divided into three categories, two technical and one cultural. We have, let's say, a quite unique opportunity here to do the fact that we speak on one side with a Microsoft community, which notoriously is very Linux-oriented, and all
the OpenStack.
Sorry?
You mean the open source community is like.
Yeah. Okay. Sorry.
I'm
thinking always a little bit ahead, So, and on the other side of our customers, which need to move specific Microsoft oriented workloads on top of this OpenStack environment. Okay. So, I was saying the first two technical. One side is, of course, on the hypervisor part, and that part is basically done. I mean, we did a lot of work, starting with Folsom, in enabling Hyper-V as a top-class hypervisor inside of OpenStack, okay? So if you take our bits, which are part of Nova, part of Neutron, part of all the major components, of course, in OpenStack, you will be able to leverage all these features that Hyper-V is currently offering, okay? One important thing that quite a lot of customers or users still don't, don't consider is that Hyper-V is a free, absolutely free environment that you can choose as a hypervisor, okay? You can, of course, go also with the Windows Server option, okay? But there is quite a large user base that still doesn't consider Hyper-V as an option because they think that they have to pay for it. Is that true? Okay.
And to add a comment to that, I would say they also consider it as Windows. Uh-huh. Hyper-V is a virtualization platform, right? It can be part of Windows, but it doesn't. You don't need to have the entire full-blown GUI. Like most people don't understand that it is a slimmed-down, stripped hypervisor-only functionality, and we provide all the
And when we say all the functionality, it means that it's not trimmed down like maximum a given amount of RAM or you don't have some features like live migration. It's everything there, okay? So the second part is related to the platform as a service, if you want, or anyway, it's related to Windows as a guest operating system, okay? That's the area in which we are particularly focused today. So for example, some advertising here. At 5 o'clock, 5:20 to be exact, I'm gonna have a session showing how to optimize Windows workloads on top of OpenStack. So on top of KVM, on top of Hyper-V or whatever, okay? Mirantis, for example, is doing an excellent job with Murano in enabling and simplifying all these challenges. The reason here is that, as it has already been said, there are solutions which are pretty much Linux-oriented, okay? Our task and our job here is to take them and make sure that they work in the best possible way also with Windows. Okay, that's what we are doing. So for example, we are creating heat templates for Active Directory, for SQL Server, for Exchange, for SharePoint, you name it, okay? And with that in mind, that should solve actually what are right now the, let's say, asynchronies between the OpenStack technology as a wall, to say so, and the Microsoft-related infrastructure world, okay? The other part I was saying is more cultural. OpenStack workloads are typically what are referred as kettle. I don't know if you're familiar with the kettle versus pets terminology. Kettle are virtual workloads which can be simply shut down and restarted and deployed without affecting the application as a whole, to cut it very short, okay? Think about a web application in which you have 50 nodes, okay? You get to, I don't know, Black Friday, and you need 200, you just spin up another 150 machines, and on the next day, you just kill them. No problem, everything works, okay? They scale out very, very easily. On the other side, quite a lot of our customers, which are using Microsoft technologies, are trying to bring workloads which are like Exchange applications, SQL Server, mm-hmm. or SharePoint, or solutions which typically don't scale in this way, okay? They are more similar to what I refer to pets, no? And this is actually related to what Gosha was referring to with clustering, okay? So one challenge that we're facing now is bringing the Microsoft cluster concept, okay? So failover and fault tolerance based on the concept of clusters inside of the OpenStack environment. That's actually one of the big leitmotif we're going to have in the next months.
So from that, I glean two key areas that are challenges. And to bring it to a really high level, first is the typical sort of pet scenario of a Microsoft workload. The second would be the sort of the Windows IT pro and their lack of DevOps mentality experience. Because a lot at the guest level of what we're doing with Heat, Murano, Cabinet, all those things are enabling DevOps on top of the guest platform, essentially. And you know, from a personal experience, I've been doing a lot of work with Puppet on Windows as a platform. And one of the things that we find in the DevOps community is that there is not the richness necessarily of modules or recipes for Windows. So I can agree with you that I think there's an education barrier that might exist at this layer. How do you think we address that? What's the best way to address the cultural change? Because essentially what's occurred in the industry is a cultural change around the paradigm at which we run our infrastructure, right? How do we address that for the Windows IT pro? Let's start with you. Joe?
Sure. And I think you really hit on the nut of the topic, right? The reality is that you have Windows certified engineers, you have Windows certified admins, and for the longest time, and if you think about key tenets of cloud, I mentioned continuous deployment. That notion really in the broader enterprise really doesn't exist, right? It's a version to version certification and validation, and that's how upgrades are rolled out. In the largest scale clouds, it's when updates come out, it gets rolled out, and it they're tested and they're on on build servers. It's a very different model. I honestly think we as vendors and those of us in the community, I think there is a need to actually build, like I said, some of these best practices. I think we are, to some degree, kind of ignoring the cultural problem that's out there. I think the tool sets are starting to emerge, but we're still acting like they are DevOps oriented people, that we're just giving them Microsoft tools. And I think we had to realize that they are Microsoft experts. They know what they're doing when it comes to Microsoft tools, Microsoft processes, but we've not given them the tools to actually come over to this side of the change. So in terms of what we can do, I think education is a big part of it. And I think there are ways, there are tools, there are shims, there are middleware things that we can do to start enabling that. The Crowbar project, I'll just take a second and talk about, the Crowbar project was intended to do that. We actually introduced it at Dell a few years ago to start training our customer sets of how DevOps works, of how this model works of continuous deployment. And the notion that there are problems that they encounter, I'll just say a lot of my other partners that also do cloud technologies, when we actually go on site and do installations, you know, this whole notion of cloud in the box, and I don't want to get political here for a second, but that's a difficult notion for me, cloud in the box, just because I've been on site multiple times, and routinely, almost 100%, we'll go in there, and the customer will have a set of decisions already made about here are the network configurations, here are the ports, here are the applications we need to plug into. We deploy it, and it's wrong. It's not right. And it's not because the customer is wrong. It's because we just don't exactly know what it's going to be like until we get it and do it once. When you have a continuous deployment model, that's fine, because you can deploy it once, you can see where you made your mistakes, you can tear it all down, and you can redo it just in a matter of hours, and you'll be back to where you started. That's not how traditional IT is really run. So I think products like Crowbar, to some degree Fuel as well, and you know others that are out there, it's a bridging technology that starts saying, look, you need to look at how these tools work, because it tells you how the future of architecture is going to work. And I think it is small steps like that that we do at a rapid pace, but small steps that will get people there. That's that's what my thought is.
Sure.
Take
the next one.
Yeah, I'd say it's not really a Microsoft Windows problem. If you look at Microsoft Windows, if you know anything about kernels, you'll find it's pretty darn similar to Linux. And I was around when Monad was started, which became PowerShell. This was brought in by a team, based actually by a lot of input from Intel quite some time ago, to make Windows a highly scriptable, highly scalable operating system. So you have two types of people. You have, we call them the next finish people, which is lazy sysadmin. By the way, how many of you run Microsoft in your environment today? Whoa. What do you other people do? How many run Linux in your environment today? Okay, so my point is, and when you talk about things like Exchange and SQL clustering, that's an app-level problem. So you can take Microsoft today, and you can write stateless applications that scale horizontally. There's nothing inherent about the operating system. Where you run into troubles is actually it's an overall issue. We call it traditional enterprise legacy apps. They're built for scale-up. By the way, we've got to do something about the pet and cattle discussion, because as soon as we go to India, it's not going to work out very well.
still not great anywhere.
Right, exactly. I don't eat beef. But fundamentally, this is, and that's not even actually a Microsoft discussion. That's applications that have been built. You have applications on Linux today that are built from a concept that they cannot handle failure of the infrastructure. They do not scale out horizontally. They are not stateless. So, I totally agree. It's a change to sysadmins. There's a lot of sysadmins in enterprise IT shops, regardless if it's Linux or Windows, that are trained to deal with next finish. Linux gave us an opportunity to approach it slightly differently, because everybody came at it from a scripting perspective. You learn the code, you know the code, you survive on the code. You can't really do that with an operating system that's closed or with applications that are closed. But this it's not just a Windows problem. It's much broader.
Didn't we say that Microsoft is open source before?
So for all of you, that's the group that I work in at Microsoft. So,
yeah, I guess, I should probably agree with you. Let's ask that question. For all you guys that do Linux today, how many of you look into the kernel code? What? That's nice. I only have like 5 people on my IT team that can do that, but it's rare.
Yeah. So it's pretty correct. I mean, the fact that we have an application workload problem and not a platform problem is absolutely correct. I live actually and breathe through the two communities. I'm a Microsoft MVP on one side, where they see me like the Linux guy, okay. I'm of course working a lot in the OpenStack community, where they see me as a Microsoft guy, okay. So it's pretty funny, the situation. Anyway, I can see what...
Nobody likes you.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Everybody hates me. I have no friends. So
you've been there for a while. You get
yeah. So the main idea is that those group of people, even if they are converging very slowly, okay, are still different. And for a couple of, let's say, generation, product generation, they will still be like this, okay? We can just ignore the problem and say, okay, the future they will merge, but it will miss that we will just miss the next, like, 10 years probably, okay? Or we just try to figure out a way to make both of them happy. For example, in our the installer for the Hyper-V driver is made in a way in which it can make happy the next Finnish people, because it's actually pre-populating all the, I don't know, glands, rabbit parameters and everything for you. You just have to fill in the values and press next, okay? But on the other side, when it's finished, it's a fully blown Python environment that you already know on KVM, okay? It's just wrapped in a regular Windows service. So again, the Windows guy can just say stop service, start service, and so on. The Python-oriented DevOps can just go inside of the Python code and do exactly the same things that they do on KVM, okay? So that's, for my opinion, the way for approaching, making them happy on both sides. Crowbar is an excellent example of another approach to solve a problem, because you're hiding all the, or most of the complexity. Okay, it's gorgeous, the fact that you can say, I just want to have three Hyper-V nodes there, two KVM there, one controller over there, okay, and off you go. So most of the people out there are simply scared of changing their technology infrastructure, okay? They don't have anything against it, okay? We are very far away from the ages of, you know, Microsoft, the evil empire, Linux, just a bunch of hackers, okay? Both of them make, the solutions make great enterprise solutions on one side and customers on the other. So we have to work with both of them and make them happy on the same side. Another thing that scares people, just to finish, is licensing, but I think we'll talk about this later.
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah.
We can address that.
Yep. So from my perspective, I believe that right now there is a biggest problem in the attitude, because like when you spoke with a typical like OpenStack engineer, he will say that OpenStack is for like cloud aware application, and I believe that's wrong, because OpenStack is a platform which should be suitable for any workload, for anything. And actually what we need to do as a community, so we need to change our view on the things, and we should understand that OpenStack should be really open to any kind of workload, like pets or cattle, it doesn't matter. So OpenStack should be suitable for everything, and everything should be manageable and usable independently on the operational system. And I believe that I see a demand that more and more enterprises, they're using actually mixed environments. So they use Linux where it is suitable. They use Windows when they have like some specific applications, and that is the right way to do. So we should not stuck with one operational system. We can leverage the benefits of both different operational systems, but we need to make sure that OpenStack itself is agnostic to operational system. So so there should not be like second class citizens.
So I agree. From a personal perspective, one of the my background is about 10 years or so in Windows and Linux interoperability, and one of the things that drew me personally to OpenStack was the promise of ubiquity. Because as a cloud platform, you know, with networks for a long time, we were looking for network ubiquity, and we achieved that through TCP/IP. With OpenStack, we can achieve platform, you know, virtualization, cloud platform ubiquity through OpenStack, right? And as you said, there's along those lines, there's also internally, as we've seen over the course of this cycle, challenges with keeping ubiquity as the focus of the project, right? So what do you think we can do to encourage, as you said, further adoption or understanding that Windows can be a first-class citizen both above and below the control plane of OpenStack, right? How do we encourage you know, our customers to, you know, break through their fears and start consuming this great work that we're doing, and also encourage the open source community that we're part of, that this needs you know, the level of attention that it deserves and needs the support from the community, that, you know, to continue forward. So I guess what are your opinions on those two points?
Well, I start this time. Okay. Well, one important thing would be, of course, if we can somehow merge a little bit more the communities with Microsoft help on this side, right. Of course. Some people believe that OpenStack is in strong competition with System Center, for example, or with Azure. It's not, for my opinion. It's just fitting another niche, another completely different area. Okay, we can argue, of course, on this assertion, but that's how most of the people feel it, generally. The other thing is that our job here as software developers, as experts in the domain and so on, is to make sure that the products we write are absolutely targeted towards those people. They have to be amazingly simple. They have to be what Microsoft did back in the PC era, okay, 20 years ago, in which people anyway were choosing it because it was very simple to deploy their applications, okay? We have to bring it to the cloud today. But at the same time, we have to make also all the other guys happy that want to be sure that they are in control of the code and they can hack into it. Solutions like System Center or vSphere or similar, they simply don't apply here because DevOps don't like the idea to have a closed box there where they cannot put their hands, okay? So that's why OpenStack is definitely a winning solution here.
So is there a place for Hyper-V then as a hypervisor, being it's closed? And
there already is a place for Hyper-V within OpenStack.
Even though it's closed source, we'll be off.
Yeah, we actually, you can run Hyper-V within your OpenStack cloud instead of.
But to get the communities happy and talking and trusting each other.
So to put things in perspective, it's already in production at CERN.
So what do you
expect? People are using it in production.
So what do you expect Windows to run on Hyper-V or Windows to run on KVM eventually? How is it going to?
So there's, I can give you my answer.
Hyper-V is integrated into Open-V or OpenStack, doesn't mean that people are going to use it.
Well, I guess to answer your question, you have a point, right? As we see what's happening in cloud, okay, the reason there are different hypervisors is because those different hypervisors address different technical issues, right? In some cases, we switch to container because we want the performance to be closer to the iron. In some cases, we switch to Hyper-V because we have licensing challenges and we want better support for our Windows workloads on top of the hypervisor that we're going to run on, right? And there's obviously, you know, the pluses and minuses of each hypervisor platform that you're going to choose, and in some cases, it really doesn't matter.
Yeah, Peter, I would add, I don't think we know. I don't think we know yet, and I don't think we have to know at this moment. The reality is right. Alessandra's right. The customers I have that are running OpenStack, it's not their first cloud, and it's not their first virtualization environment. They've got other stacks running. And when it comes to things like scale or when it comes to new workloads, that's when they're coming and talking to me about OpenStack. What Hyper-V enables me as a vendor to do is not to have a multiple all OpenStack conversation for a customer that doesn't have anything to do with open source. I can actually go and have a conversation that says, you can use a Hyper-V that you're comfortable with, that you've already got, and we can make OpenStack run on it. It's rather than going KVM, OpenStack, you know, open source, Crowbar, all these things that are extremely wicked scary to someone who has been doing Microsoft Pure for their whole their career. This enables me actually to give them an entry point to at least have that conversation. That's where I'm going. I don't know yet whether, you know, Linux workloads running on Hyper-V. I don't know what that's going to be. But I'd say another tenet of this community is that we don't have to predict it. You know, there's an agile methodology here that says, let's go do the things that we think we need to do, and let the markets tell us where they want to go. And so I think this enablement is extremely important because, like I said, it's that bridge that's going to start connecting a broad base. I actually believe that Microsoft, the Hyper-V market, the ESX market, I think those markets are
gigantic. There are a lot of people out there that need the technology advances that we're starting to see. They just don't have a means to get where we're going to go unless they, you know, buy the whole package. And so I think the Hyper-V work that we're doing here starts bridging that there. And it's right. We are going to see, I think even in 10 years from now, I don't think you're going to see one cloud for every, you know, ubiquitously. I'm a server vendor. I don't see one server manufacturer in every data center. I don't. And I recognize that's part of our design tenets now. I think with clouds, you're going to find the same thing. There are going to be pros and cons to each. There are going to be different clouds that are better for different users. And I think that Hyper-V, this advancement, is just one way to start making that happen and allowing more people to understand how OpenStack can work.
Just to add another comment to that, with the diversity across all the projects in OpenStack, that's truly where we achieve ubiquity in the core project as a whole. So without the diversity at each level, each of your drivers for Cinder, each of your drivers for Nova, all the other projects, having those plugins available to enable additional exterior technologies in the overarching OpenStack ecosystem allow us to have the diverse environment that we bring together every 6 months, right?
One important thing about choice, you don't have to choose. Yeah. I mean, you can have your Linux workloads on top of KVM and your Windows workloads on top of Hyper-V. That's what most of our customers are doing. For example, including also CERN, for example, as an example. So that's the beauty.
OpenStack is a control plane. I think a lot of people get confused on this was always the goal. You have flexibility. You have choice. You can put a Hyper-V. You can do ESX. Yesterday, I did talk with Dan Wendland on the what VMware has done in regards to controlling and connecting into OpenStack. But I think one way to make this ubiquitous, it'd be awesome if Microsoft jumps full force in and takes part in the OpenStack community. Peter, you're doing a great job, but we need the Redmond guys to come on.
I would love personally.
If they watch the video later, are we filming?
But to be fair to Microsoft, the recent announcement that Cloudbase and Dell and SUSE announced around Hyper-V support was backed by Microsoft. Microsoft lent us their support. So it's not that, and I think this is kind of a community thing. It's not us DevOps people versus everybody else, right? We want to get them in. We want to include them. And in this case, it's not us versus Microsoft or VMware. Those two big companies are now part of the conversation now, right? This is where we want to go. We want to get past all the quibbling, get the basic stuff done, because you know what? There's many years of advancement that we want to hurry up and get to. So I think that's an important entity to call out.
And once again, you know, the revolution didn't happen overnight, right? We're in a new paradigm of operational,
enlightenment.
Yeah, enlightenment. Yeah. It's time to, you know, we have to educate the masses in order for people to adopt it. And I agree that there's a place for everybody in that operational environment, right?
Yeah. So, and I would say that from the OpenStack community viewpoint, right now it is important that when enterprise customers actually come back to the OpenStack community and share their use cases, their needs. Because before that, at the beginning, OpenStack was kind of like Linux geeks shop. That's it. But right now, OpenStack is pretty mature and stable, and we see that it's more and more adopted by the big and huge enterprises. And what we need as a community is to have this feedback from the enterprise customers to really understand what is missed in the OpenStack, what we should add, and what are the actual requirements.
Simply because of tools like Puppet and OpenStack, right? Whereas the headcount in Windows is going up because it's becoming really much harder to manage. And I try and cross-pollinate those, and you're banging heads together because we haven't managed to get Puppet to work against Windows. Okay.
Works great, actually.
Oh, does it? Okay.
Into our Windows Puppet community, so you can start start consuming the modules that we're producing every day. There's been substantial changes in the last 2 months in regards to Puppet modules for Windows. So please come see me afterwards, and I'll definitely.
Okay.
A great example how the OpenStack community should work. We feedback from customer and OpenStack
community. You know, that's the thing, right? Open source is about contribution, okay?
And sharing,
right? And the one thing that I know, let me take my Microsoft hat off for a minute. Traditionally, Microsoft's not known for being the best contributor. We might not accept contribution that great. But you know what, while I'm here, it's my goal to try to help everybody to make sure that, hey, Microsoft has a great representation, that where people say, wow, they're doing a great job in this space, they're trying to make a difference, and they're trying to change the perception that we once had, right? So, obviously, this stuff doesn't happen overnight. I have tremendous challenges both within the community, the OpenStack community, and within my own organization, right? Because fundamentally, there's still, just like the enterprise users out there, Microsoft's their largest enterprise customer, right? And most people might not necessarily always remember that, right? So the challenges are obviously always going to be there. But one thing that, in terms of the DevOps and the issue that you're specifically addressing, is somewhere along the line we deviated from computer science.
Yeah.
Right? And what happened is we need to rein it back in. I feel DevOps helps us do that because it allows us to abstract out the differentiation between the platform that we're choosing and turn it back into just computer science, right? So obviously, those are challenges that I've heard from, a lot of these guys, a lot of other cloud providers, a lot of people who are selling cloud solutions into enterprises. There is that huge barrier to entry that we have to overcome, and we need to just bring it back to computing, right?
Okay.
We're over time.
Thanks,
everybody.
Appreciate
you all for coming. So, if you have more questions, we can stay here outside a little bit. I mean, if you want to talk about.